Imagine yourself in space, outside the spacecraft, with the Earth a beautiful blue-white marble below you. Wrench in hand, you've been working on the solar panels, but you notice in horror that your tether is disconnected, and you're slowly drifting away from the spacecraft towards oblivion. In frustration, you're tempted to hurl your wrench at the spacecraft, but Isaac Newton whispers in your ear, "Bad choice." His law of action and reaction says, if you hurl the wrench at the spacecraft, you'll go in the opposite direction. So you turn and fling the wrench away from the spacecraft, and physics takes you to safety. Think of the riskiest thing you've ever done. Space travel is probably more dangerous. Death rate in space is 3%. That's about the same as flying wearing only a wingsuit or base jumping. Two of the five space shuttles were lost catastrophically on takeoff and landing, with the death of 14 astronauts aboard. A rocket is a barely contained chemical explosion. And space is a brutal environment. Total vacuum, high energy radiation, hundreds of degrees temperature variation from day to night. Without a spacesuit, after 30 seconds, your blood would boil, your lungs would explode, and your brain would shut down. But at least no one could hear you scream. Yet we're witnessing a surge in space travel. After half a century, when the space race was a geopolitical pissing contest between the world's two superpowers, we're seeing a commercial space industry emerging. Fewer than 700 people have ever experienced the thrill of zero gravity, or seeing the Earth from above. But that's changing as reusable rockets bring down the cost of getting into orbit. Each Apollo launch cost about $5 billion. And each of the 130 space shuttle launches cost $500 million. But companies like SpaceX are using stronger, lighter materials and reusing almost every part of the rocket to bring down costs dramatically. Of course, they're still using chemical energy. So a SpaceX rocket, even though it's the size of a skyscraper, is just a cousin of the tiny liquid-powered rocket that Robert Goddard flew 100 years ago across his Aunt Effie's frozen cabbage patch. Nonetheless, we're gonna go into space. And in the last few years, you've seen civilian astronauts in orbit and even doing spacewalks. Eventually, they'll go to the moon and Mars. The time has come to consider our future off Earth. So, a show of hands. No questions asked tomorrow. How many of you would go up? Not too many. What if it was as safe as driving a car and cost no more than a fancy cruise for a once-in-a-lifetime trip? Oh, quite a lot more. Okay. It's in our DNA to explore. After humans left Africa, they migrated across Asia and down through the Americas in a strikingly short time. Animals travel long distances to mate or to follow food sources, but only humans explore for exploration's sake. There's a variant of a single gene that correlates with the distance nomadic tribes travel across continents. It's called the explorer gene. Curiosity has taken us across the face of the Earth, to the top of the highest mountains, and to the seafloor. And now it's taking us off Earth. Are you content to watch those space explorers on TV, or are you tempted to try it for yourself? If you're hesitating, it's understandable. There is skepticism about space travel. It's an expensive indulgence. Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk, they're just billionaires with boy toys. And we have plenty of problems on Earth. Why mess around in space when 3 billion people don't have clean drinking water and the planet is burning up? And if you did go to Mars, you get a lifetime's dose radiation on the 8 month trip. And that nearest hospital, well, that's 50 million miles away. If we did have a colony on Mars or a base on Mars, it would be a fascinating sociological experiment. Imagine the first off-Earth baby being born and a new branch of the human tree. The gene pool of the colonists will be small, accelerating evolution. So after a few hundred generations, they could turn into a new species. Going to Mars is not on the cards for a couple of decades, but imagine you're in the first wave of colonists. After a rough few months, life has settled into a routine. Taking the rover out for a spin, you're stunned at the beauty of the rugged red landscape. But then you spot a dust storm on the horizon. It looks huge. It could last weeks or months. You rush back to the base to give warning. That dust will coat the solar panels, killing power to the station and threatening the life support systems. As you approach the airlock, you realize you've forgotten the access code. So you stab at the keypad as the dust approaches. Earth orbit is much more attainable. It's just half a day's drive, straight up. If you spent a couple of days in Earth orbit, what would it be like? Orbiting hotels and spas are coming, but this is not the Marriott. Accommodations will be cramped. You'll be eating freeze-dried food. There'll be no shower, no flush toilet. You better like your travel companions. You might not even enjoy zero gravity. 1 in 10 astronauts got spacesick, and some were so debilitated they couldn't function at all. On the other hand, many astronauts reported a sense of awe and exhilaration called the overview effect. Seeing the Earth from above, no walls, no boundaries, no barriers, no countries, set against the black of the inky void of space, could be a life-changing experience. The possibilities are endless. Imagine a space elevator. A space elevator is a cable going straight up, suspended against its weight by the spinning of the Earth. No rocket fuel required. Solar-powered lifters go up and down, bringing the cost of getting into orbit almost to zero. We don't have materials light enough and strong enough to make a space elevator right now, but in a couple of decades we will. And if we had one, we could lift toxic and radioactive waste off the Earth, put it into orbit, and send it gently into the sun, solving a chronic environmental problem forever. Is all this just science fiction or fantasy? No, it's becoming real. The Space Club is still quite special. More people have won Nobel Prizes than have been in Earth orbit. 10 times as many have stood on the summit of Mount Everest. But that will change as the costs come down. Within a decade, it'll cost no more to go into space than a luxury cruise, something several million people do every year. So which would you rather, jostle at the crowded buffet line of a cruise ship, or watch the entire planet slide under your gaze every 90 minutes. If you have the Explorer gene, pack your bags. Thank you.